And we're live.
Hey, I know that song. Oh yeah. How you doing, John?
I'm doing well. I'm excited to be here on a sunny day talking about the extremists with you.
Yeah. Oh, you know what? I wasn't going to do this, but I had to.
Time for Club Joe.
Can you hear that?
Yes.
Time for Club.
I like this one.
It's time for Club Joe.
Oh, you know? It is time for Club Joe.
I know. So enthusiastic. All right.
And Club Joe was something for those longer time fans, had an earlier life, of course, back when there were some Club Joe experiences at live shows for a while.
Yeah.
And this is sort of a fun way to bring that back a little bit.
Yes. Yes. Club Joe, virtual Club Joe.
So I thought I'd start with a few stats about the extremist. I mean, it was released back in July of 1992, which makes it 28 years old. This July. So
Wow. That
doesn't make you feel young. I don't know. your first studio album, obviously one of the most popular albums, number 22 on the Billboard chart, 200, stayed there for 28 weeks.
Wow.
Weeks.
Yeah.
And then hit the top 50, six other countries. Obviously the big hits singles wise, Summer Song, Friends, Crying, certified gold in December, only 6 months later.
Yeah.
And got a nomination at the Grammy Awards.
Yes.
So.
That record actually went platinum, but by the time, Relativity Records was in kind of disarray, a couple of years later, got absorbed by Sony. We lost the trail of the sales. So much of it was on paper, but we eventually got our platinum certification in a couple of different places, but we never got the award ceremony for it, but what a tale to tell. I mean, the making of the record was fun, traumatic, a million crazy stories, lots of funny gear, some of the gear I'm holding right now.
Yeah. Why don't you talk a little bit about a few of the pieces of gear you've got around you that tie into this album?
Yeah, not too much stuff, unfortunately, but somewhere in California, I still have that, the 1969 Marshall stack, full stack, still have it. It's been used on just about every record since then, but I had picked it up halfway through the project. And this guitar was designed during the making of the album, and so it wound up in phase three of the recording. I had Jeff Bauer's snake guitar over here. Check that out, huh? That's beautiful.
Wow, that is just a work of beauty.
Isn't that really, that is just all over the place, you know? A very thick sounding guitar. This wound up on Rabina's Blue Sky Happiness playing the melodies and solo and stuff like that. Used it a lot on records.
Here's a nice little photo of that from back in the day.
Yes. So I can recreate that. Except for all the whatever that is coming out.
There's something missing.
But you can see the Marshall there. And then there's my sister Carol had done that Rainforest guitar, that's still stolen, by the way. I'd like that back. The Black Dog and the White JS that were used on the record, which I don't have here with me, are right there. I do have Chromeboy. Chromeboy's right here. Yeah, so this guy's here. And as you can tell, it's been beat up like crazy.
That's what I loved, is what it is.
Yeah, so this is the early days where I hadn't quite figured out how to chrome a piece of wood without it getting all nasty and dangerous.
Well, I feel like we should at least say hello to all the fans. Obviously, we can't, take all their questions all the time because we'd be here for hours. But
they are
all out there on Facebook, on Twitter, on Twitch, on YouTube. And it's great to have them all here to help sort of launch this thing off.
Yeah.
Why don't we just dive right in? I know we don't want to go forever. So talk a little bit. I mean, you mentioned already that this album had a few different cycles in it. You know, you had different phases going on.
Yeah.
So why don't you give a quick overview of what those were, and then we'll talk a little bit about each one.
Sure. At the end of the Flying in a Blue Dream tour, I got together with what I call the Jagger Band, which was Phil Ashley on keyboards, Simon Phillips on drums, Doug Wimbush on bass. They had been part of the Mick Jagger Band that I played with in 1988. And I brought them up to Bearsville Studio, Woodstock, New York. And we spent 3 weeks there trying to do just about all the songs I think that eventually appear on the album were attempted there. And we got some brilliant stuff. New Blues, Rubina's Blue Sky Happiness, parts of some other songs. But the vibe of where I was going didn't really turn out to be exactly what I wanted. So I had to sort of pack up, go back to San Francisco and figure out with John Cuniberti exactly what it was I was aiming for. So phase two happened, and that was kind of like all over the Bay Area. We recorded at Fantasy in Berkeley, Coast, Hyde Street, maybe somewhere else in the city. We got through quite a lot of stuff. I mean, like 99% of the guitars on Summer Song and Why, and a lot of stuff was actually done there. We finished New Blues and most of Rubina's Blue Sky Happiness. And then I gave up around March of that year, March of 91. Took almost a year off, and then starting up in February, started down in LA with the Bissonnette brothers and Andy Johns along to engineer and co-produce with me. And that lasted until the end of May, I guess, something like that. So it took about 5 months. And but the result was great, because what I was looking for was that live classic rock band sound. The funny part was that when I finished it and I thought I'd finally done my tribute record to my classic rock roots, the grunge movement was in full swing. So I came out of the gate completely out of step with the trends, but I still love the record, and it really stood up to the test of time. You know, the performances are great, and the decisions that everybody made in playing and producing and engineering all wound up being extremely fruitful. And made the Extremist a record that I really love.
Yeah, you know, I thought to keep this thing sort of interactive a little, why don't we just take a couple of questions real quick, and then we'll go back to talking a little bit about each of those phases.
All right.
And so obviously a lot of questions about details about songs and stuff. So we're just gonna pick a few. On Facebook, we have Dan May, who says, I remember reading a small guitar article announcing the birth of ZZ around the time the Extremist was released. What a special time it must have been for you. Was there any particular family member you could share with us that ultimately went into the album's DNA?
Well, all of it. I mean, I think what moment stands out for me is I arrived in LA to start rehearsing with Greg and Matt Bissonnette. And as we're setting up, I get the phone call from Rubina that she just found out she was pregnant. So that was an amazing moment. Of course, I felt like, what am I doing in LA? I should be back in San Francisco with my wife, you know. But it's one of those things where you realize, wow, this is, although I'm here and I'm thinking this record I'm making is the most important thing, and it's, you know, my third attempt at pulling the record together, that suddenly brought me back down to earth, because I realized what was really important is that we were going to have a baby. So that was an amazing moment. So that the whole production of the record, we're expecting parents for the whole thing. And ZZ is born just a few months after the record gets released. So, and then I was off on tour. I could talk about that for hours. But wonderful memories.
I know there's a lot of great detail about this in the Strange Beautiful Music book.
Yes.
And I remember you talking about, just it really helped reset your sort of anxieties and stuff about creating a new album, that when you sort of had this idea of like, I'm going to be a dad, like it sort of resets you a little bit. Yeah,
it does. It certainly does. It makes you really organize what's important and what you shouldn't be fretting over, you know, and yeah, no pun intended.
Yeah. All right. Here, let's do a song specific one now from another one from Facebook. Ross J. McGregor. When you wrote Rubina's Blue Sky Happiness, we hear an almost bagpipe like sound. Was this on purpose? And you could you share a little bit about how you approach writing thematically?
Yeah. So, you know, what was really happening in that album was I was channeling some kind of Celtic thing. And I was kind of struggling with it in the beginning because, you know, I'm Joe from Long Island. So what do I know about Celtic music? But I'd written all this stuff. The song was about Rubina and our experiences up in Lake Tahoe and just how many great, you know, moments and wonderful times we had up there. And so the song was innocently just written about that happy feeling. Fast forward, you know, to producing this, I've told these guys this stuff, you know, the stories behind these instrumentals to kind of motivate them. And we're in the studio and we're doing take after take. We're trying different things, changing guitars, cymbals, all you know, kinds of things like that. And then, of course, when you're recording, what happens is very often, you know, there's tension. But when you get to the end of a take and you know that you've nailed it, there's a kind of sense of relief. And then when you get past the point when you know it's beyond the fade out that the fans are going to hear on the record, musicians start to really relax and play some silly things just to goof on each other. So I guess what happens is we get up to that point. They've been listening to me tell them the story about how I'm trying to put a Celtic vibe into this thing. And Phil Ashley just gets this look on his face across the room. I see him across the studio room because we're recording kind of live facing each other. I'm playing an acoustic guitar. And he gets this funny, mischievous look on his face. And at the end, all of a sudden, he dials up this bagpipe sound and he starts to play this bagpipe thing. And of course, Simon Phillips, being British, knows exactly what to play behind that. And he just sort of launches into this, you know, what is it? Uilleann drumming, whatever the Scottish bagpipe drumming thing. And we all just have a really good laugh. None of them think I'm ever going to use it. But, you know, the months go by, I'm listening to that and I'm recording over it. And I get to the end of it each time and I go, you know, this really fits somehow. It's sort of, it kind of doesn't make sense, but in a way it echoes the way that I think about a theme or a person or an event. It plays like a movie in my head, like a memory. And so there would be some things that are maybe seem incongruous, but actually sort of massage the dream and make it interesting each time, because it adds a bit of mystery to it. Makes you think, you know, like, what is that element? Why is that there? And so they were all pretty shocked when I left it in there, because we were literally laughing. And I think Doug and I just stopped playing because we were just cracking up so much that Bill had started that, you know, just as a joke. So good times.
Speaking of the folks from the Mick Jagger band and being up at Bearsville, here's a photo for you.
Yeah, there they are. It's amazing. Phil is such an amazing musician, a fantastic keyboard player, from acoustic piano all the way to the deepest coding of synth instruments. He's really a master. He actually, I've put some solos on a crazy big band record that he's working on right now. We've been doing it remotely, obviously, but I'm looking forward to Phil's release, hopefully this year.
Very cool. So being out there at Bearsville, you had this idea of is going to be this great live feel, as opposed to the first couple albums, which were a lot more you and John Cuniberti really hunkered down and creating stuff in a way.
Yeah.
And but as we know, there's three parts of this album, you know. Yeah. what worked and what didn't work about that? And you know, John was there with you. You know, what was that experience in a nutshell?
Yeah, well, you know, the cool thing with the safety net, the ultimate safety nut, that's a funny one. The safety net really was John Cuniberti's attentiveness to the best recording practices, because even when I was playing good, he was recording. When I was playing bad, he was recording. When I was searching for something, he was recording. When I didn't know what I was doing, he was recording, and he was archiving everything really well. I mean, perfect example is that crazy
Joey. Joe.
What's that?
I'm sorry. I've got a surprise for you, and I slipped a little out there. We'll come back to that in a moment. We'll come back to that in a moment.
Well, anyway, Woodstock Jam. John recorded us in the barn after dinner and a lot of wine, just trying to work out a crazy song idea I had. And thankfully he did, because it's some of the most beautiful but outside playing we ever did as a unit. And I wanted people to hear, you know, how out we could get. But during all those sessions, you know, it's really hard to explain what I put John through, like recording songs like New Blues or Summer Song. He'd have to sit there and record me for hours while I chased a nuance of a phrase, whether it was one beat or eight beats. I'd work on something for hours, days, to try to get it just right, to make sure that the guitar playing was truly lyrical and not just a demonstration of technique. Because I always hated that sound. So sometimes you just got to sit there and work it out, but you need to have a very patient and professional partner, you know, to watch over you, to make sure they're getting everything and keeping you on track and reminding you to tune up and to take a break and all that kind of stuff. So what I think about those phases, about how, you know, John was looking over me, taking care of things for two of the phases. And then there was Andy, who then inherited all this great work that John had done and said, like, I don't want to do that over again. That's obviously great work, so let's just use it somehow. And that's,
let me stop you there for a second. You just threw Andy's name just sort of as Andy, but Andy is quite an Andy. talk real quickly about introducing us to where Andy, who Andy is and where he came into the picture and how that happened.
Yeah, the great Andy Johns, famous rock and roll producer. And, you know, everybody, when they hear Andy Johns, they think about When the Levee Breaks, you know, Led Zeppelin IV. He was there, the younger brother of Glenn Johns, who I also work with, both brothers, amazing musicians and engineers and producers. It was actually my manager, Mick Brigden, who brought him up at one point, late in 91, when I'd been taking a good, I don't know, almost 9 months off from working on the record. And he mentioned Andy, and I thought, well, that's crazy. Like, why would he do, you know, a record like this, you know? But it just turned out to be really cool. I went down to LA. I met with Dave Jordan, Mike Klink, and then I went over to Eddie Van Halen's place, and I sat down with Andy, and we just played the demos. We talked about things, what I was trying to achieve and everything. And I just thought, this guy, I think, gets it. I think he recognizes the work that's been done that we should keep. He knows exactly what it is that I'm trying to do in finishing it and making this sound like a live band, really rocking out. And so from there, we decided to start working. Andy Johns, you look him up.
Again, the book has some great stuff about Andy and the Bissonnette brothers and the whole session down there. And in fact, we're going to do something at the end of this where we give away a copy of the book, right?
Yes.
We've got a copy right there. We're going to find someone
right here,
pick someone and have you autograph it to them on the air, as it were.
I'm going to do that. Yeah.
I think what we're going to do is we're going to ask people in comments to do something a little bit silly, and we'll just choose someone at random, which is going to be, describe your favorite Joe Satriani album using only emojis.
Ooh, wow. So, I like that.
So we'll see what happens, and we'll pick someone out and do that at the end. Time is just zipping away from us. I know we talked about doing this for half an hour, but it's like zipping. So we're going to keep moving here. And I've got some weird stuff going on here that I don't know what's going on, but I think we're going to have
Joey,
to sort of roll with
Joey,
it.
Joey! Joey! What are you doing? We miss you.
The Lum Lum Tree.
What are you guys
We miss
doing?
You, Joe. We thought we'd surprise you and pop in there for this cool thing you got going.
Wow.
This is Greg. Matt, great to see you. And we have some pretty funny stories, and probably a lot of them we can't talk about. But I just remember recording the Extremists when we went in, and Andy Johns was producing, We got into the studio. We just auditioned for your band, and we got in by the hair of our skinny teeth. And we got in and started playing with you, and we rehearsed. And then we went in, set up our stuff. And I remember going in there and playing the first song. And I'll never forget, after we tracked, and we're just like in the studio, had no idea what it sounded like. And then going into the room and hearing what Andy, his idea, it sounded like Led Zeppelin. And we both were just freaked out. Pretty amazing.
Pretty amazing. I remember the first rehearsal we did at Leeds. And Andy came by, and he looked like he was about 100 feet tall. And he's looming over my drums, and he says, "What would you like your drums to sound like, Mike?" And I went, "Wah! How about any of those sounds you got with Mr. John Bonham, sir?" And he goes, "We can do that." And I remember my great friend Myron Grombacher loaned me his camouflage big drum kit, and we took the front head out and put a little foam in there. Andy cut a 421 and soldered it, dangled it in there. We had two heads with no holes, no dampening besides a little bit of foam. And then he mic'd up the room like crazy, like he obviously did with Bonham. But he also took the drum sound and ran it through a big PA. Do you remember there was a PA in the room at Ocean Way? He brought a PA system in, and then he mic'd up the PA in the room, and we just had this. And I remember the song that, you know, I think, Joe, you had a groove programmed, and it was really cool. And he said, "I like that, but what would you play to make it a bit different?" You know, that's not a good Andy Johns accent. What would you play to make it a bit different? And I said, "What if instead of bop, if I went bop?" And he says, "I like that. What do you think, Joe?" And you said, "Yeah, I like that too." And we all played, and we played this song, and I'm sure you remember this beat.
Yeah.
We went in and we were trying, holy smokes, what a sound, what a vibe. Yeah. And every song, I remember going up to that warehouse in San Francisco and doing the video for the Extremist.
Yeah. And that summer song, we did the video, and the cars were blowing up all over the place. And like, you were there, I remember at this racetrack, wherever that was.
In Saugus.
Saugus. And you were playing your guitars, and we were in the back changing room, just waking up, and we were we're hearing cars crash. We look out there, and you're in the middle of their plant, and these cars are whizzing by it. The insurance alone for that must have been insane.
You must have met Mick Brigden. Must have had a nervous breakdown. Oh no, my artist is getting 10 feet away from a car blowing up. People are coming into the guy's restroom and throwing beer, and the racers, our cars are going close to the audience. That was a fun video.
And all through it all, we had a great time because you're such a great guy, Joe. Thanks for letting us come in here and mess up your show. But it's great to see you.
And then we took it on the road. And the Allied album, Time Machine. Anyway, what a ball. We love you, Joe, and we miss you. Greg and Matt Bissonnette, the Bissonnette brothers, signing off. Much, much love to you and Ravina and ZZ, and a lot of love. Take care.
Love you guys. Thank you so much. What a great surprise. Mr. Luini, what are you doing?
You know, you got a lot of people who love you out there and love taking a chance to jump in. No. So I thought it would just be nice to hear from someone else's perspective some of the stuff that went on down there at Ocean Way with Andy Johns and some crazy stuff with videos and all that. And let's take a question which is sort of related to that drum pattern that he did about Friends. So Steve Burkett from Facebook says, the first three songs, Friends, Extremist, War, were all tuned down a half step. Yeah. With the remaining songs in standard tuning, was there any specific reason for this beyond them sounding cool, or was it an early experiment in the half step down that you now use?
No, that was Andy Johns. He actually, you know, he had this thing. He would, you get into the control room, he'd turn the music up really loud. He'd like stand like this, you know, and kind of rock out by the speakers. And then he'd go, Joseph, I think we should tune down a bit. And he'd have us tuning all different ways until he felt his body rocking the right way. He did it with Chickenfoot. Like when we were doing Turning Left, he made us record that thing all day long in all these keys. By the time we got to the take that's on the album, Mike and I were dying from trying to do that lick all the way down in this the final key, but that was part of his genius, was knowing not only how to record something, but little subtleties of arrangement. If he heard instruments that, and he thought they could sound better if they were pitched somewhere else, he would suggest it and see if the musicians could respond. So that was one of the first things we did, because we wound up with, so that's how we... That was all Andy's idea to pitch it down. And then, so we kept it for those songs. He didn't seem to mind that the other stuff was at 440. Yet, like I said before, he really wanted to keep the work that John Cuniberti had done with me back in New York and San Francisco.
All right. How about a little look at this? So that's a definitely what you're talking about, the timing when the album came out. You got a little of a grunge look going on there.
Yeah. Oh, that was really funny. I can remember, well, first of all, there's the opening scene is like 7 in the morning, right? And I'm leaning against this pole at the Saugus racetrack. And the director says, no matter what happens, just keep playing. Like, don't even worry about what's going on around you, right? And so I'm sitting there, I'm leaning against the pole, I got my sunglasses on, so you can't really see what I'm thinking about. And I just start to see everybody back up, because I'm, you know, what you don't see is, you know, the cameraman and the director and the assistants and everything. And they start looking, there it is, there's the scene, right? and obviously what they saw was this car coming straight for the pole. It was the first, like, 20 seconds of the song, of the filming of the video, and that car was totally trashed. And I just remember feeling like a jolt coming from behind me, thinking, that's really weird. Why is everybody running away? You know?
Oh, dear.
Anyway, the sad part about it is that, you know, we lost a car. First 20 seconds of the shoot, 7 in the morning, one of the cars that cost a lot of money, you know, and the driver, gone, out of commission. So that was probably one of the ones we blew up at the end of the video.
Right.
I'm sure that's what we did.
All right, let's do another question. This one is sort of a combination of two people. We got Magneter on YouTube and also Ricardo Artigas on Facebook asking about Motorcycle Driver.
Yeah.
One of my favorite songs ever. Title pretty much says it all. But what amp and guitar were used, and was it inspired by yourself? Are you a motorcycle fan? What was up with that?
Okay, so that it's a funny little twist of fantasy, right? So that's I'm on tour in Australia with Mick Jagger. We're staying in that's not my phone. Whose phone is that? Wait. Hello? That's a little Christopher Guest reference. Hi, Chris. So anyway, we're staying where are we staying? The Siebel Townhouse. Used to walk out hang out on the street there, lots of liveliness going on, street life out there. And there was this one little cafe that had a Sega hang-on video game, but it was upright. Like, you just walk up to it, put your quarter in whatever, and hold on to the controls. So I used to go there in the morning, drink my espresso, probably 8 of them, you know, and play this game. And I started thinking about that song all the way back then, just sort of my own little soundtrack, because this game was sort of like on the sidewalk, couldn't really hear the music so much. So I was playing some music in my head, so to speak. And so I wrote that, and then I used, I think, if I could do this for a second, I think I used this guitar. So that's the Chrome Boy. And then, not this guy, but then while I was, look at that, right? Beautiful 58 Tele. Now, this is actually an Esquire, but it's had a million different pickups, and we've tried just about everything with it. But Chris Kelly found this for me when I was in L.A. recording with Andy, and it arrived quite early, And, you know, Andy Johns was always bugging me about having what he used to call proper guitars. So he just wanted to see Les Paul's Telecasters, Stratocasters, you know. And so this thing came and it got pressed into service, and then it's been on every record doing something ever since. So it's providing that chimey kind of sound. I had some notes here about Motorcycle Driver, and I was surprised
to find. Well, since you brought that Tele out, one of the other questions was from Laurent Barkowski, who said, what tracks was the Telecaster played on and why? So you're sort of addressing that right now.
Yeah. So those are great questions. So there's Motorcycle Driver, and it was mainly, you know, I don't have this plugged in. It's that chimey thing that Teles do that is really great when you add them to, let's say, an Ibanez and a Les Paul and maybe a Rickenbacker, and you blend them together and they turn into something really unusual. So because it was a new guitar and wasn't quite sure what to do with this thing, we wound up making it the sort of like the fairy dust on a couple of songs. So it's probably, I'm thinking, I know it's not on Friends, it's not on The Extremists, it's not on War. I think it's probably Motorcycle Driver. That might be it for that for that album. As a matter of fact, The Extremist. And then what follows next, of course, it gets really exploited for the Time Machine record. It was used almost exclusively for the title track Time Machine and All Alone and Mighty Turtlehead. And then I use it for on the Crystal Planet record. It was used for some really cool rhythm guitar sounds. Anyway, very versatile guitar, these Teles. When I was in high school, it was my second and main guitar for a good chunk of time before I moved on to a Les Paul. I had a 68 Tele. It's in the book. There's a picture of it in the book somewhere. But they're great. Teles are great. They have a thing. They do a thing. And when you need that thing, there's no substitute for it.
Well, here, again, time is zipping by, so I think we're going to have to see how quick we can get through some of these other things. We could talk all day, but one of the things that I know was sort of an unexpected boon, I'm going to show you a little something and you can talk about it.
Uh-oh. Ah, yes. I can see it.
Yeah.
This commercial, yeah.
So this Sony Discman Walkman commercial had a sort of important element.
Yeah. Well, I had a funny relationship with MTV. This was a bit of a problem. They didn't know, I don't think they really wanted to play our stuff. And so we come up with this song, and we'd already had this problem with Flying in a Blue Dream, where for Big Bad Moon, they objected to the fact that I was playing guitar kneeling in a puddle of water, and they wanted us to put, you know, electricity effects so we could warn kids not to play their amps while they're kneeling in a puddle of water. And then you know, we came across this situation with them, and they objected to the fact that there were cars driving all around me, and I was standing in the middle of a racetrack playing guitar, and it was too dangerous. They didn't want kids to replicate what I was doing. And so there we were. We had just spent an enormous amount of money on this really fun video, and they wouldn't play it. And that was their excuse. So while this is leading up to the MTV Video Awards, which were a big deal back then, and we got contacted by Sony, and they wanted to use the song for their commercial. And we said, well, if you don't talk over it and you put a chyron at the end, kind of like what they did with music videos back then, to say the name of the song and who the artist was and from what album, then it's a go. So we made a deal with them. And then when the MTV Music Awards was aired, they just bought like every spot. So every commercial spot, because this was broadcast television, they played that commercial twice. And so I was on the MTV Awards far more than I would have been had I been a guest. And it, you know, I became a winner because it was rebroadcast around the world, and it made Summer Song my biggest international radio hit. So it was a win-win all the way around.
Very cool. I mean, those sorts of things where they say, you know, you can plan, you can practice, you can write the best music, you can play it the best possible, but sometimes it's those unexpected magical things that you stumble into that make a difference.
Yeah, yeah. And you have to be ready. You know, as I've told a lot of people who asked me at the G4 clinics, you know, you have to be prepared for luck. I mean, that's really what it is. You just got to be ready for luck. And so we were ready. When the phone call came, we had a video and we knew what to do with it. So,
yeah. So I think we should do our winner for the emoji giveaway of the book. I've sent you a little message that I think you can see who the sort of randomly chose winner is. Tell me if you can see that.
Scott Russ. Am I saying that right?
That's a good question. He's watching on YouTube, and and his emojis were an airplane, a blue heart, and the zzz, which you can guess might be flying in that blue. It's a blue heart, and so I thought it was pretty clever. That's a good one. So
I'm just signing this to Scott right now. So this is the book, by the way. There we go. Yeah.
And so Scott, please send your address to webmaster@satriani.com, and we will get this out to you. And thank you for watching.
Oh yeah. And I think because it is Club Joe, I don't know what you look like, but I'm just going to imagine, you know, on a crazy day, you might be thinking, no. And he's thinking, he goes, I bet this is what Joe looks like, you know, when he's thinking about what kind of solo to play next. And this is definitely something. And then he's got a little thing here, the initials, SR. That's for Scott, by the way. Okay,
just see. Nice.
All right.
I feel like this is my escape from being quarantined and locked down at home. I feel like I'm at the boardwalk, and I just went up to a caricaturist who did this.
Yeah, your turn to say, hey, that doesn't look like me.
Yeah, I'm a little happier than that. I don't know what you're talking about.
Oh, man.
Here, here's another photo. Tell me what you think of when you see this one.
Yeah, see, now that's 6,000 Sunset. That's Ocean Way. And we're all hanging out trying to look really cool. I got my fisherman's hat on. I got the JS6. My, you know, my shirt's open, so you see a little fruit salad coming through there. Andy, I think, was a little upset that he wasn't really sharp and in focus for that photo, but he was just moving around so much. You know, he was just like a hurricane, that guy. But you can see that unbelievable drum setup that he had going for Greg. That's really cool. The PA and it's just great. When I look at that, I could stare at it for hours. You know, it's just wonderful memories of just, we were just so shocked at how great it sounded in there and what Andy was doing for us. And it really made us play so much better than we played before.
It's a very cool room. Very impressive.
Yeah.
So let's do, all right, we got to wrap up here, but let's do another question here. This is from Instagram, from the one Bij, I'm not even sure about that one, but says the Extremist felt like a live album of new material that was carefully planned, but delivered with intensity and the biggest guitar sounds I believe you've ever recorded. Did it come together as effortless as it sounds, or did you have to work really hard at bringing that feeling to the record? Obviously, that's a lot to try to answer, to condense it down to a shorter answer, maybe just really like, how important was it to get a certain feel across on this album?
Yeah, it was obviously, you know, if you read the book and you know, you think about the other things I said today on this session, you know that it took a long time. It took way too much money, and it was a lot of physical and emotional hardship that went into just trying to stay focused and get the record done. But behind it was a passion for the music and the songs, and that's kind of like what gets you through these things. I was looking for that sound of a live band somehow, but it needed to be structured. I have to say that the biggest problem I've always faced in doing rock instrumentals with new people that come in is I have to explain to them it's a rock song. It's not a fusion, jazz, demonstration record kind of thing. Forget about displaying technique. It's really a song. So let me tell you what the song is about. Play something specific for the song. And then the team, whoever I'm working with, as far as co-producer, engineer, we also have to get together with this, with that theme that each song is about something specific. Just like if I was going to sing and I was going to sing a song like I Believe, it's lyrics, it's specific, it's a story. So that informs how we record every instrument and how we ultimately mix the song. So you have to get everybody on the same page. Like, I know there's nobody singing, but it's not a jam. It is a specific song. So we do work all those details out. And then once we get really comfortable with this really tight structure, we say, that's your spot to get lively. This is your spot to get lively. Some players are really great. You can say to them, hey, you can get lively everywhere. As long as you hit this accent, you go there and there. Remember, that's a bridge. That's a pre-chorus, so on and so forth. Just about everybody I play with, eventually they bring so much to the party. It's really great. And they make the thing happen. Just like what Greg was talking about. You know, he comes up with an idea. He throws it out. Andy loves it. I love it. He runs with it. So, you know, that's why we invited him, because we knew he was great. He was a pro. And we were hoping that he would come with some fresh ideas to take some of the, let's say, the program stuff I had to heart, and but then bring it to life, make it real, make it sound like what you had suggested, a live band.
Right. All right. I think that we're entering our last moments, and I wanted to...
John, can I interrupt you for a second? This is a funny little thing. Only guitar players will get this, but it's one of the secrets of that record was that both John and Andy understood that in order to get certain things about the band to sound big, you had to get the guitars to get skinny. And this was something that I would spend so many hours with Andy watching him how he did it. It was so weird, because you plug in and you want the whole world coming out of your amp, you know. But he'd look at it and he'd listen to it and he'd say, like, well, that's just going to cover up everybody's part. And so, you know, eventually he would get the guitar to sound just like it would as an integral part, fitting in with this huge drum kit and huge bass guitar. And this was the key to making it really sound big. And this is what I had heard on Led Zeppelin records, which was that sometimes those page performances in your mind, you think they're huge, but when you go back and you listen to the record, you go, wow, there's a lot dialed out. It's a skinny guitar sound, but it's the music and the spirit that actually sounds huge. It's not necessarily the amp, you know, with all the bass turned up or something like that. And so that's really the key. And they, you know, both John and Andy have different ways of going about it, but the two of them together produced just an amazing sound on that record because of their attentiveness to that particular detail.
Well, it's incredibly fortunate that you had people like that to work with on this album. Like, you didn't just have one great, you know, engineer, producer and stuff. You got actually multiple one on that. I thought that since what always happens after a great album is finished and is released is you go out on tour. So I thought maybe we'd share just a little clip of a performance here that we just sort of watch for a moment here.
Take a look. Welcome, Joe Satriani.
I know this is something that is a look with like green back. You do get that. I'm not sure.
You're wearing a jacket, Matt.
I love Matt's stamp. Got
it. Take it over.
That's rocking.
Yeah. You know, I was so ill.
Oh my God.
That evening, I had the worst head cold ever. I had never taken so much Sudafed in all my life, I remember. Because I was so afraid that I was going to like sneeze in the middle of the broadcast, but that was great. Yeah. I, you know, there's a funny moment after that was done. Jay called me over to sit down, and I forget the guest, but she was very upset that she was going to have to get up and move aside. And I would sit next to Jay for a couple of seconds.
that was her moment, whoever it was.
And you know, you see the way I look, she was probably like, what the hell is this guy?
Well, maybe you should have offered her your hat.
I know. Like, oh man. And I think he called Satch Boogie Snatch Boogie.
Oh no.
Never. Yeah. Well, he's a comedian.
It was intentional.
That was really funny. Great memories, though. Great memories. I love that shirt. I got that from someplace on, where was this? Hate Street somewhere. Some store. Dalgeets or something like that.
Oh, we did get a word back from Scott about the pronunciation of his name. He said, it's not Russ. It's
Ruse.
Blues. Yes, Ruse.
Ruse. Great.
So thank goodness, in this modern age of live streaming, we can get these important questions answered in real time. All right. Well, Joe, thank you for taking time out of your lockdown. I know it sounds like you're working on a lot of other little projects, keeping busy, certainly.
Yeah.
This is the first inaugural episode of our wonderful Club Joe streaming sessions.
What is that green stuff all over me, by the way?
Yeah, that's a good question. Perhaps, well, no, I don't think it's a different virus, but we will be doing another one of these. The plan is in 2 more weeks. And you want to give a hint of what we might be talking about that time?
Yeah, I'm hoping that we can talk about Chickenfoot. A million stories, the two albums that we did, the live DVD. What a crazy band. Oh my God. And so different from the Extremist recording experience. Great stuff to talk about. Interesting gear, guitar techniques, just me out of the instrumental guitarist vibe and in a band vibe is pretty remarkable shift. You know, talk about shape shifting. That's some shape shifting right there.
Absolutely. And of course, there are actually so many great questions that everybody sent in, and there are a lot of them really detailed. Obviously, some gearheads, some players and stuff, just like, what amp this, what guitar that? And it's worth repeating that a lot of, or all of that information is in the book. I mean, it's not only a whole chapter about this album and from a narrative standpoint, but at the end, the huge resource of all of those sort of details, right?
Yeah, and I did discover more stuff. I wanted to say to Doug Aldridge, amazing guitar player, musician, and I was looking through these cards that Mike Manning had written out during the Extremists, and they were just hidden away somewhere. But Doug had lent me a couple of Marshall heads and I think a dual rectifier, one of the first ones, when we were doing the last overdubs for the Extremists. And I didn't know Doug at the time. He was a friend of Andy's. But I got a lot of stuff from Andy Brower Rentals, that made the Extremist sessions work, and from good friends like Doug, who just always got a great ear for guitar tones and had some really sweet amps that he let me borrow. So thanks, Doug.
Well, maybe if you have time amidst everything, we can put a few more updates out on social for things that aren't in the book that maybe were new things you discovered. So everyone keep an eye on that stuff. And thank you. This was fun. Did we have fun?
We had fun. I was supposed to record this thing where it says, and that's all for Club Joe. And let's see.
And that's all for Club Joe.
And that's all for Club Joe.
There you go.
And that's all for Club Joe.
All right. And signing out.